I'd like to welcome everyone this evening to the McClure Community Good Friday Service. Wonderful. Good to see so many smiling faces. Hopefully your day has been a good one. Before we get started, I would like to make an appeal for a ministry that got started up this last winter. The Lutheran Church and us have been doing a ministry called CHALK. I don't know if you've heard of it or not. It's Community Homework Assistance and Learning Club. We've got 6 or 7 kids that come real regularly now. And if you would have anything on your heart for helping kids learn how mainly to read, that's the main goal of this, is helping them do their homework and helping them get a little more comfortable with reading. And if you would be able to volunteer either a Tuesday or a Thursday, we meet with them after school, and the program runs from 3:30 to 5 o'clock. And the kids start showing up as their buses come to town. So if you would, please see Pastor Mark or see me or call either one of the churches and let us know if you'd be interested in helping out with that. Because it's really going well, and we've already noticed a difference in 5 of the kids' grades already, and they're happier and feeling better about school, and they're starting to tell some friends. So we're expecting to get a few more because we've had some success. Let us pray. Dearest Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this time to come before you. We come before you and we open our hearts to you, Lord, and we ask that you pour your Spirit afresh out upon us. We gather in this time to celebrate the death of your Son, Jesus, on our behalf. We thank you, Jesus. We ask you to bless us and our time together. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.
Even so, you also walk in the newness of life. then planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection.
Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin.
For he that is dead is free from sin.
Now if we be dead in Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him.
Knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, dieth no more, death hath no more dominion over him.
For in that he died unto sin once, but in that he liveth unto God.
Likewise, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that ye should obey it in the lust thereof.
Neither yield ye your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin,
but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God.
And thanks for what God has done for us and given to us. We'll receive offerings. Another advertisement. Many of you know that the food pantry for the area has been at St. Paul's Church since the late 80s. And I want to thank you for all those of you who have made gifts of food, of money, of both, over the years. Though the economy is improving in many places, you know that for many households it's still a challenge. We are having people of all ages who need what you and I offer. So I'm grateful to receive your gifts of money. Everything will go to buy the things that we need for our families but are not donated, as well as food stuff that you may have. If you brought them in back, you can leave them there, or we can bring them up here to the altar. Who's going to receive? I need a volunteer.
Yeah, no, you can do that.
Okay, you got the job. Son Jesus, for all that he gave, not for his sake, but for our sake. We give thanks for the hearts you have moved to faith, the hearts you have moved to thanks, the hearts that have moved to provide for our neighbors who have needs at times that just get to be so much. Please use these gifts and use us to show that they are remembered, that their needs are met, and that your love for them ever flows. And we ask this in your precious name.
Psalm of Ascents. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplications. If you, O Lord, should mark iniquity, Lord, who could stand? But there is forgiveness with you, so that you may be revered. I wait for you, I wait for the Lord. My soul waits, and in his word I hope. My soul waits for the Lord more than who's watched for the morning, more than who watched for the morning. O Israel, hope in the Lord, for with the Lord there is steadfast love, and with him is great power to redeem. It is he who will redeem Israel for all its iniquity.
Was his name born in a manger? awesome and amazing all the time. And for him to think that we are worthy of his attention, it blows my mind. Well, I want to share with you from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 27, and give you a few of my comments and thoughts God has led me. If you want to turn to that passage, it's Matthew 27, beginning with verse 27. I see that's in the bulletin. That's a little bit earlier.
Okay, where do you want to start?
On 27. It looks good to me. I want to talk to you today about Friday, but Sunday's coming. You may have heard that message before, but I've heard the title, but I guarantee you this probably is going to be a little bit different from what you've heard before. Beginning with verse 27, it says, "Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the praetorium and gathered the whole garrison around him. And they stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him. And when they had twisted a crown of thorns, they put it on his head and a reed in his right hand. And they bowed to the knee before him and mocked him, saying, 'Hail, King of the Jews!' Then they spat on him and took the reed and struck him on the head. And when they had mocked him, they took the robe off of him and put his own clothes on him and led him away to be crucified." That sounds like Friday. It's a pretty difficult situation. In our world, and as I was working for 39 years at a factory, I always enjoyed looking forward to Friday. Friday was going to be a great time. I was going to be off of work. And many of you probably have thought that as well. And Sunday was a dreaded day because the following day I'd have to go back to work. And at that time in my life, I didn't know Jesus as my Savior. And so Sunday, I had to cram everything in, as many people do. Don't take time for God. It's my last chance, my last fling before I got to go back on Monday. But it's Friday and Sunday's coming. And once you know Jesus as your Lord, every day is Sunday. Even if you have to go and to work on Monday, it's Sunday. It changes around. But here we find that the soldiers and the governor took Jesus into that praetorium. They didn't treat him very nice. Like some of us sometimes. We don't actually put a crown of thorns on him, or we don't spit on him. Some of the things that we do are very displeasing and very obnoxious before you know him. Verse 32 says, "Now they came out and they found a man of Cyrene, Simon by name. Him they compelled to bear his cross. And when they had come to a place called Golgotha, that is to say, the place of the skull, they gave him sour wine mingled with gall to drink. But when he had tasted it, he would not drink. Then they crucified him and divided his garments and cast lots, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophets. They divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots." Doesn't sound like a very good picture to me. Friday is pretty dark. How did we ever give it the name Good Friday when such things happen to our Lord and Savior? But actually, our ways are not God's ways, and our thoughts are not his thoughts. That's what the scripture tells us. And after all, whose opinion matters? You see, sometimes the things that we term bad in our lives are actually good for us. They challenge us and they lead us to places where we would have never went before. They change us. Sometimes they make us depend upon God more.
Right.
I can remember several times in my life when God had to get my attention and he put me flat on my back in a hospital so that the only way I could look was up. Maybe you've been there as well. There have been dark times in all of our lives, I'm sure. And we've thought they were terrible and just something that we couldn't bear. But when we've been through them, we find out that God was there and he was leading and guiding and directing. And he has brought us to a different place. Yes, it's Friday, but Sunday's coming. Verse 38 says, "Then there were two robbers who were crucified with him, one on the right the end. No Sunday for me. Sometimes we feel that way, don't we? That it's Friday, and there certainly is never a ray of sunshine going to come back into our lives. But we forget that God's in control. And at those moments, we need to remember that He is in control, and that His ways are higher than our ways. He knows better. The Scripture tells us that He only sends us good things. That's just a fact. You either want to believe it or you don't believe it. It's your choice. Verse 39 says that those who pass by blaspheme Jesus, wagging their heads and saying, "You who destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself if you are the Son of God. Come down from the cross." And they're actually trying to prove who He is when He doesn't have to prove who He is. If you are the Son of God. And sometimes we have ifs, don't we? Where are you, Lord? Why is this happening? If you really love me, why is this happening? Anybody ever say that besides me? Don't hit anybody on your way up, okay? Be careful, okay? Be careful, boy. He's bigger than you are. But sometimes we wonder where God's at, and we question, if you love me so much, why is this happening? Sometimes we don't have all the answers, do we? We don't understand why someone is taken from us, maybe at an early age, or maybe at a little infant. Maybe it's a disease that comes our way. Maybe it's a tragic accident. Why did you let that happen, Lord? We don't see only a little portion of the picture, but God's in charge of the whole canvas of our life. Even verse 44 says, even the robbers who were crucified with Him reviled Him with the same thing. And now and then we find the passage here tells us about when Jesus was actually on the cross. And it says that from the sixth hour, which is 12 noon, until their ninth hour, which is 3 in the afternoon, there was darkness over all the land. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," that is, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Jesus actually said that. My God, why have you forsaken me? And we have that same question sometimes, don't we? Lord, what's going on? I don't understand. And it's okay for us to do that, because Jesus did. And if it was okay for Him, it surely ought to be okay for us, right? Jesus questioned, although He knew. You see, He had prayed in the garden shortly before that, "Father, if there's any other way, take this cup from me. Is there any other way, Father?" And I know that we don't like to hear God say no to us, but He said no to His Son Jesus. He said, "No, Son, there is no other way." So the old plan that was in place, the offering of the bulls and the goats and the heifers, all of that blood, wasn't good enough. It just was not good enough. These people that I've created and love so much are different from bulls and goats and heifers. And so it's going to take your sacrifice of your life and your blood to save all of mankind from the beginning of time on. And if you read the scriptures closely, you'll find that right in the very beginning, God had a plan for us. And that plan was for His Son Jesus, who wasn't born yet in a manger like that His Son. Wasn't born yet, but yet God had a plan for us clear down here in 2016. And if the world stands for another however many years, that plan is still good for all those who will be born tomorrow and the days after. You see, we see just that little snapshot of a picture of God's great big canvas of life. Some night when it's clear, outside, get where there's hardly any streetlights, and look up and see how big God is. Because He's in control of the universe. He's in control of the universe. He created all of it. If you think about it in Genesis, when it says that God spoke light into existence, light travels at 186,000 miles per second. I don't know about you, but that tells me God's pretty awesome. Mm-hmm. He doesn't mess around. He's in control. Well, Jesus asked that question, God, why have you forsaken me? And then there were some of those who stood there, and when they heard that, they said, this man is calling for Elijah. They're human too, aren't they? Sometimes we don't get it right either, correct? They're mixed up. They thought he was calling for Elijah. Not so. Immediately one of them ran and took a sponge and filled it with sour wine and put it on a reed and offered it to him to drink. The rest said, let him alone. Let us see if Elijah will come to save him. Sometimes we look for the wrong things, don't we? We just simply don't have a clue to speak of. I know a lot of times I don't have a clue. And I say, what are you doing, Lord? I don't understand why this is going this way. And He says, just hang on. I'm about ready to surprise you. You see, there's a lot of surprises that God has in His Word if you just look at it. Stop and think about it. We're going to get there. He had some surprises in store that day. Verse 50 says, and Jesus cried out again with a loud voice and yielded up the spirit. The last words that Jesus said was, it is finished. Father, it's finished. I have done your will. Not my will, but thy will be done. As you have asked me, I have fulfilled what you asked me. And now all of mankind has the privilege of having their blood applied to the sins. And it's done. It's over with. Aren't you glad that Jesus paid the price for your sins? We're free. Then behold, the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And the earth quaked, and the rocks were split, and the graves were opened. And many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. And coming out of the graves after His resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many. That'd be a surprise, wouldn't it? God's in the business of surprising us. Did He ever surprise you? Stop and think about the times you thought it was going to go one way and He surprised you. He has to have a sense of humor. Right? I'll give you an 8-1 point, okay? I look in the mirror every day and that's a surprise. Well, I'll take your laughter as an amen. But God has surprises for us, and certainly the curtain being tore from top to bottom signified that God's in control. And He opened up the way for us to come to Him, where before the people had to take their requests and their sacrifice to a priest and have him offer them. But now God has opened up the way, and we can walk boldly into His presence and ask. Jesus said, ask what you will. Ask what you will. Come into God's presence. I don't know about you, but I feel His presence here tonight. I know our brother over here prayed, fill us with your Holy Spirit. That's what God wants to hear all the time. Father, make me more like your Son Jesus. Fill me with your Holy Spirit that I may live and glorify you and praise you because you have purchased my salvation with the precious blood of Jesus. Well, there was a lot of surprises that day. So when the centurion and those with him were guarding Jesus, saw the earthquake and the things that had happened, they feared greatly, saying, truly, this was the Son of God. They were a little surprised as well. I think there's a lot that I won't be able to say tonight about this passage. The man who carried Jesus' cross was certainly surprised, and he thought, wow, what a Friday. This wasn't on my plans. But he was compelled by the government to carry Jesus' cross. The guards, they just thought that was just another Friday, just like every other Friday. Had to do what the boss said. The two robbers couldn't see past Friday. They didn't see that Sunday was coming. It was only Friday. The chief priests all said it was Friday for you, Jesus. No Sunday for you. You're going to be done. You're going to the cross. You're going to die. No Sunday for you. Just Friday. But what did they know? Sometimes when we think it's over, that's where God begins. Friday for Jesus was God's will, and Jesus knew that Sunday is coming. I don't know about you, but I'm looking for his coming again. When we really have Sunday. I mean, you can have Sunday every day of the week if you want. You don't have to spend your time in Friday. It may be Friday or Monday on the calendar, but it can be Sunday. You have Christ in your heart. So the centurion had a surprise, and he said, truly, this was the Son of God. Then it says, and many women who followed Jesus from Galilee ministered to him, were there looking from afar. Among them were Mary Magdalene, and Mary the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of Zebedee's two sons. And see, they were looking from afar off, and they seen that it was Friday, and Jesus had been crucified, and oh, what a heavy load it was on them. What do we do now? It's over. No, it's not over. We only see the little picture. We think it's Friday, but actually Sunday's coming. Sunday's coming. This last section I want to share with you talks about a man named Joseph of Arimathea. Said, now when the evening had come, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who himself had also become a disciple of Jesus. This man went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate commanded the body to be given to him. And when Joseph had taken the body, he wrapped it in a clean linen cloth and laid it in his new tomb, which he had hewn out of the rock. And he rolled a large stone against the door of the tomb, and then he departed. And Mary Magdalene was there, and the other Mary sitting opposite the tomb. We don't know a whole lot about Joseph of Arimathea, or at least I don't. Maybe some of my brothers here know more about him than I do, but there is something that I do know about him. It's recorded here that Joseph, who himself had also become a disciple of Jesus. That's a big statement. He believed in Jesus. He knew who Jesus was. Probably had seen some of his miracles and probably had heard some of the things that Jesus had said, like, I am the light of the world, or I will never leave you nor forsake you. I will be with you always, even unto the end of the age. But Joseph was kind of special, I think. You see, as I said, he was a believer. He was one of Jesus' disciples. And Joseph of Arimathea went against the grain. He went to Pilate, after all. Wasn't very sympathetic to believers in Jesus. And he risked his own life. And I believe Joseph of Arimathea thought, if Jesus died for me, I ought to be able to follow in his footsteps. And he risked his own life to ask for Jesus' body. And why did Joseph of Arimathea do that? Because when Jesus was on the cross, Joseph was on his mind. And Joseph recognized that and he said, he's willing to die for me. I'm willing to live for him. And that's exactly the same thing that God's talking to each of us tonight. The fact is that Jesus did die on the cross. He was buried in a tomb, but now he lives. And one day he's coming back to take us to be where he is. In the 14th chapter of John, you'll find it, he said, I am the way and the truth and the life. No man comes to the Father except through me. He also said, do not let your hearts be troubled. For where I go, you may be also. He said, I'm going away to prepare a place for you, that where I am, you may be also. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you so. Folks, you might not think that all of those things are true, but Jesus doesn't lie. God doesn't lie. And he said, one day I'm coming back to get you. But in the meantime, I am going to send you the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, to lead you and to guide you into all truth. Aren't you glad that the Holy Spirit is active in your life?
Yes.
Sometimes he has a big job to keep us in line. I'm not pointing out there, folks. Sometimes the Holy Spirit has a big job to do. We have a tendency to get out of line. It's awful quiet. It's awful quiet. But I'm so thankful for the Holy Spirit that guides and directs and leads us into all truth. And he loves us when we're out of line, even if when we're in line. Joseph was a man who stood up and said, even in, regardless and in spite of it, I get crucified myself. I'm going to honor and serve my Savior. I'm going to make sure he has a proper burial. Now, I've never been over to Israel and seen any of the tombs that those would be like. I'm told that that was such a huge stone it would take several stout men to move that stone. But to actually carve that out of the rock must have took Joseph many, many days, hard labor to make his own tomb, and yet he decided that, no, all my work is okay. I'm going to let the Savior have my tomb. Nobody had ever been buried there. It was a special place for Joseph of Arimathea. And he said, I'm going to serve my Heavenly Father. It doesn't matter what it costs me, I'm going to do it. And you see, I think that's what our attitude should be. Our Savior Jesus Christ died in our place on Calvary's cross. And that should move us to the point of saying that whatever the cost is, I'm going to show you that I love you. And I'm going to show you that I thank you for loving me. As weak and marred as I am, you still love me. All I can say is thank you, Jesus, for dying in my place. Would you bow your heads as I pray? Father, we thank you for this opportunity we have to gather in your house, to be in your presence, and to sense the Holy Spirit moving and guiding and directing in our lives. Father, I know that sometimes the things that we need to do aren't easy. The challenges that we face seem to be difficult. And there are days when it, on end, when it seems like Friday will never end, that we need to remember that yes, it's Friday, but Sunday. Sunday's coming. And Father, we thank you for the promises in the book that if we confess our sins to you, that you are faithful and just to forgive us of our sins, and that the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us. Father, a long, long time ago, I knelt at an ottoman in the village of McClure, Ohio, and gave my heart and life to you. It's been the best journey so far that I've ever been on. And I thank you for your Holy Spirit that guided me and directed me to do that. Father, I believe that you died for each and every one of us. You're not a respecter of persons. There might be someone here tonight that never asked you to forgive them. Just right where they're at, help them to bow their heart to you and say, Father, forgive me. I accept Jesus' sacrifice in my place. Father, I thank you and praise you for being in my life. I pray, Lord, that you guide and direct in everything that I do. We thank you for this Good Friday. And we praise you and thank you. And we ask these things in Jesus' name and through his blood. Amen. God bless you all.
Faces his darkness this night, and his followers face darkness this night and tomorrow. Hearing words that he said, promises he made, but seeing the facts in front of him, things are dark. I pray, Lord, to be with each one here who is facing a darkness, or several of them. Let you hold them close to your own great heart, because no matter how far away we may get out of line or move away from your way, we are never so far that we are not yours. You have made us, you have claimed us, you have reclaimed us. So may all who feel that all might be lost, may they sense that you are finding them, you are calling to them, you are walking them, you are leading them. And we pray, Lord, through your Holy Spirit, that this word, this truth, this surprise may become part of us. And we trust it to letting go of our ways and to follow your ways. Lord, thank you for light that comes into darkness, for hope that comes into despair, for peace that comes into anxiety. For you who have come into this life. We give thanks in the name of your Son Jesus, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us go in peace. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.